Hey there, Walter here. This is a very, very special destination video I'm sending out here. We're going to actually go on a Tiger cruise aboard a United States aircraft carrier. So as is typical with every destination video, run for the mountains, tell the neighbors, hide the dog. This is destination Tiger cruise. And I will be right back with you after this brief word from the cat. Hey there, Walter here, and this is a pretty special trip we're going on right now. So we're going to be heading over to a what's called a Tiger cruise on board a United States Navy aircraft carrier. So let's go ahead and see what we can do here. Getting ready to take off now. TV screens here showing pictures of green foliage, colorful flowers, playing nice music, quiet music. So I think we're on our way to Alaska. here at the airport in Honolulu, Hawaii, on the island of Oahu, I believe it is. And we're getting ready to get on a bus to go over to the pier where the aircraft carrier is at. The carrier we're going to, the USS Carl Vinson. It's the last Tiger cruise that's going to be on for a while before going in for maintenance and repairs and everything, so it's going to be a really good time. That's where we're going to be at for the next week. I'm probably going to stay for the whole week, but that's a big ship. Okay, now that we've seen some of the sights at the naval base, time to look around before we get started on the Tiger cruise. I was told that the vessel directly in front with all the lights on it is the USS Missouri, yes. And then over here, of course, is the USS Arizona Memorial. And there's a jet that's flying around right now. So I'm going to shut this down right now. And then tomorrow morning we'll get started with the Tiger cruise. Good morning. We are less than 20 minutes away from actually taking off from Pearl Harbor, so got a lot of stuff going on here. And by a lot of aircraft. So, yeah, got a lot more stuff planned here, so I'll record that when it comes along. Well, I know what killed the skull.
A little bit of background about Pearl Harbor itself. It's a little over 4 miles from where we're right now. We're here from the Hotel Piers, about the 50-year formation at the channel. Pearl Harbor was known to the native Hawaiians as Pupuloa, so Long Hill, and also Waimoe, which means a Pearl River. The first Western ships that we're aware of to come out here were the 1820s. That was the Royal Navy actually did a survey of Pearl Harbor. Now there was a coral reef, it was a dead reef that blocked the channel entrance, so they couldn't get any large ships in here. But they did do a survey of this harbor in the 1820s and determined this is a fantastic harbor to you could put sail in the entire Royal Navy in here. The only problem with getting something like a coral reef, nobody was going ready to do that at that time. The United States started coming on here around the same time. U.S. exploration expedition. That was in 1825. So lots of interest in Pearl Harbor, but not until something could be done about that reef. The reef was actually dredged in 1910, started dredging in 1910 after the United States had annexed Hawaii after the Spanish-American War. And then by December 14th, 1911, we had a naval base starting to be built here. 1913 is actually when the administrative offices moved in. And then by 1919, we were dedicating this Pearl Harbor Naval Station, or Naval Base. Actually, as they were doing salvage operations, 1 year after the attack, they stopped those operations on December 7th, 1942, and actually had a reef ceremony on the wreckage of the USS Arizona. Albert Price, who was the Austrian architect who designed that memorial, he had actually escaped Austria when the Nazis took over in 1938, made his way eventually over to Hawaii. He intended the design of this iconic structure to be simple, yet elegant, with a subtle symbolism reflecting his belief that America is basically a peaceful nation that would have to be provoked to war. Once aroused, would persevere to ultimate victory. He opened the memorial spanning the final resting place of over 900 sailors and Marines would provide the opportunity for visitors worldwide to reflect on the meaning of vigilance in the face of tyranny, selfless courage under fire in the defense of freedom for the cause of peace. So 1,177 sailors and Marines were killed on the Arizona. Their names are on the memorial in the shrine room where you see the sculpture there, closer to Fort Island. As I mentioned, there's over 900 souls that are still on board that ship today. For those that got up to the flight deck a little bit later, you're going to hear a couple commands coming from us. I'll say attention to port, at which time all hands topside, please face the memorial. Then I'll say hand salute for our military members. During this time, asking for a moment of silence in remembrance. After that, I'll say ready to and carry on. At that point, please feel free to enjoy the rest of the tour. U.S.S. Carl Vinson, hand salute. U.S.S. Carl Vinson, ready to carry on. Now, the sponsor of the Missouri was the junior senator from the state of Missouri at the time. That was Harry S. Truman. His daughter broke the champagne bottle across the bow. And Harry Truman, of course, would go on to become vice president of the United States under Franklin Roosevelt. That's significant because on April 12th, during the Battle of Okinawa, April 12th, 1945, Franklin Roosevelt dies while in office in Warm Springs, Georgia. Harry Truman becomes president of the United States, and he loves the USS Missouri, so much so that after World War II, when all the other battleships are decommissioned, the Missouri is not decommissioned. And Harry Truman said, nobody's decommissioning my ship while I'm president, and we didn't. And the Missouri went on to serve during the Korean War and even into the Gulf War. So the Missouri was decommissioned eventually in 1955, then brought back into commission in the 80s under President Reagan. He actually brought all four of the Iowa-class battleships back into commission. So the Missouri is 887 feet 3 inches long, 108 feet 3 inches wide. She has three turrets with three 16-inch guns in each one of those turrets. And you can fire a 2,600-pound shell about 23 miles accurately from a battleship like the Iowa class. USS Missouri representing the Iowa class. Now, you see the white tarps there. That's really what Missouri is here in Pearl Harbor. You see that white tarp there above midships. That's the captain's veranda deck. And that is where the Japanese Empire surrendered to the United Nations on September 2nd, 1945. Admiral Nimitz represented the United States during that ceremony, and then General MacArthur represented the Allies. So you've got the bookends of World War II right here in Pearl Harbor. So it starts with the USS Arizona, at least for the world, on December 7th, 1941. That's where the United States got into World War II. And then the war ends for the world with the surrender of the Empire of Japan or the USS Missouri on September 2nd, 1945. Bookends of World War II here at Pearl Harbor. As we turn around here, you're going to start looking down and you're going to see the Southeast Lock. That's really Main Street, Pearl Harbor. That's where the Mid-Pacific Fleet is home ported. And then what's special today is you actually see all these ships here for RIMPAC. What's kind of interesting about Pearl Harbor is before 1940, there was no fleet home ported in Pearl Harbor. So the fleet didn't come until June of 1940. And that was because the Empire of Japan was making noise, as I already mentioned over there, wanting to create that greater East Asia cool prosperity sphere. And so we could not, by treaty, develop any bases further west than Oahu and the Hawaiian Islands. And so all Roosevelt really could do, he couldn't send the fleet out there to the Philippines or up to Guam, but he ordered the Pacific Fleet to be home ported in Pearl Harbor. There was actually an exercise in the spring of 1940 off the Hawaiian Islands, and after that exercise, Roosevelt just sent the fleet in Pearl Harbor. So, none of the facilities that existed of the shipyard, really none of the port facilities that you see there in the distance weren't there until after the attack on Pearl Harbor. They were beginning to develop those piers with the home pouring of Paxley and Pearl Harbor. But it really wasn't until after the attack on Pearl Harbor that the base really took on the look that you see today.
Message from the commanding officer, and then I believe there is a Tiger reception afterwards.
How we doing? Welcome aboard. Hey, so my name is Matt Paradise. I'm the captain of the Carl Vinson. It is absolutely awesome to have you guys on board. We are super proud to do what we do out here, and we love to show it off, and there's absolutely nobody better that we would like to show what we do to all the friends and family, all the folks that really enable us to do what we do on a day in and day out basis. And so we're away from home a lot, And it is absolutely cool to be able to bring some of you out with us for the next few days. So thanks for coming. I see Gun Boss over there. Gun Boss,
yes, sir.
You want to come up?
Sure.
You want to do this?
Yes, sir.
So how many folks, if this is their first Tiger Cruise? Anybody been on more than one? A couple. So we have the Godfather here. The Godfather right here. He has been on 12 Tiger Cruises. And this is his son, the Gun Boss. One of my department heads, how have you been? Must be your pacemaker.
I'll go over 32 years in April.
32 years in April. So that's pretty good. I'm just going to put this down and you want to read it?
Yes, sir. Attention to award. Commanding Officer USS Carl Vinson, CVN 70, takes pleasure in commending Honorary Crew Member Mervyn L. Bornstein for services set forth in the following citation. This honorary letter of commendation for unwavering and unselfish dedication to his son's 32-year career while serving as his most loyal and steadfast supporter. On May 18, 2012, he was made an Honorary Crew Member during his second Tiger Cruise on board USS Carl Vinson, making it his eighth total. Since that time, his efforts and passion have not waned, and he has continued to go to sea at each opportunity. USS Carl Vinson's 3 through 8 August 2018 Tiger Cruise marks an unprecedented 11th time he has sailed the high seas with his son on a U.S. Navy aircraft carrier. Tiger Cruise provides a very rare opportunity that a fractional percentage of the American public gets to experience. To not only have the opportunity to do it 11 times, but the drive and desire to do so is highly commendable and truly worthy of gratitude and respect. Since his first Tiger Cruise on board USS Constellation CV-64 in 1997, he's accumulated more days at sea than some sailors. And I am truly honored to have what could quite possibly be his last Tiger Cruise under my command. Mr. Bornstein's loyalty and tireless support of the United States Navy and its mission reflected great credit upon himself and were in keeping with the highest traditions of the United States Naval Service. Signed, MC Paradise, Captain, United States Navy.
Pretty cool. So when you get to 12, let me know. I'll give you a plaque too. That's pretty awesome. Okay. Do I have my notes? Thanks. So we got a lot of stuff planned for you today. And as a matter of fact, throughout the entire cruise. So today, we've got an air power demo practice. And so the air power demo is it's about 45 minutes long. All the airplanes take off, and then they do what is kind of amounts to an air show. But it's an air show with a, kind of a certain twist. And it's it really is highlighting the capabilities of all the aircraft and how they, you know, the combat nature of the aircraft. And so today is a practice. It's not the real deal, but guess what? It's still pretty cool. And so that's gonna, all the jets are gonna take off at 1600. That's 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And then the XO will make an announcement after the jets are all safely airborne. It'll be safe to come out onto the flight deck and you can watch them. And so there's a lot of cool stuff. I won't give it away, but there's a lot of neat stuff. But then also the following day, there's the real deal. And so you kind of want to see them both, because we have all the, like, the no kidding live ordinance is going down tomorrow. And so we got that going on this afternoon. And then also I think at 2000 is karaoke and ice cream social down on the mess decks. And then tomorrow, like I said, it's the air power demo. And then a little bit later on in the afternoon is the sea power demo. So the ships in our battle group will get pretty close. They'll shoot the guns, we'll have a drag race. I will just say up front, it's an unfair race, we never win. but that's okay. We gotta give those guys something. And then Saturday night is movie night. And so those are just the first couple days, some highlights. There's certainly a lot of stuff going on. So talk to your taggers, look at the schedule, and get out and about and see the show. It's a really cool thing. We are gonna steam about 2,500 miles from here to get back to San Diego. You can look out our window here. We're going probably about 15, 20 knots right now, and we'll keep that speed up pretty much the entire time as we go all the way across the Pacific Ocean to get back home. So do me a favor, as we get out into the ocean, you can feel the ship rocking just a little bit. And so when you're going down the ladders, and so these staircases, we call them ladders, please remember to hang on to the railing with at least one hand. And I'm sure you've already experienced the knee knockers. And so as we roll into the nighttime, just take a little bit more care when you're walking around the ship. We don't want you to park your shins or hit your head or fall down a ladder well or anything like that. So please be careful as you're arcing around. We'll get everybody back safe. Okay, so the last thing I'll talk about is our track going home. And so we are kind of weaving our way through the islands right now, and we're gonna make a right-hand turn and cruise down the eastern side of the Big Island. And so the whole idea behind that is we're gonna try to get reasonably close to the lava, to the volcano that's going down. And so I wanna tell you about that, but we can't really make it an official Tiger Cruise event because I just don't know how close I'm gonna get, and we're gonna get there pretty late at night. But if we can get close enough and it's a reasonable time, then we'll certainly put something out on the 1MC, but it's probably gonna be pretty late, maybe about 10:30 to 11:30 tonight. So I just wanted to give you a heads up. If we get close enough and we see something pretty cool, then we'll certainly make a special announcement on the 1MC, and I would just ask that you use these hangar bays here and don't get too close to the edge, please. We don't want to have to swing around and pick somebody up for falling in the water. If we do have a man overboard, that happens from time to time, then they're going to call it away. They'll call away man overboard. And so what I need you to do is just find your tiger and muster with the tiger. And we take about 15 to 20 minutes to get a full and accurate muster to make sure that there's nobody left in the water. So that'll be very important that you find your tiger, get eyeballs on them so that we know that everybody's safe. That's a pretty important thing. Okay. Can you think of anything else? Yeah, absolutely. Where is she? Hey, Lieutenant Commander Mackers, come on up. Hey, let's give her a big hand. So she is the reason you guys are all here. Imagine the amount of coordination and work that went on to put all this together. And she did a really outstanding job. So thank you very much. Okay, any questions? Nobody ever asks questions in a big group. But I'll give you a chance anyway. Hey, there we go. Yeah, there you go. You're in paradise. What else? Anything else? Oh. Yeah. Where does the term tiger come from? I don't know. Okay, well, I'll take that one as a lookup. I'll get back to you. That's okay. There's a ton of stuff I don't know. What else? Anything? The Ship Museum. Okay, so there is a little room. We call it the Tribute Room. And so it's over here next to the quarterdeck. And it's just it's a small room that's filled with sort of Carl Vincent memorabilia. And so it's right over there, and we'll get it. We'll, I think it's probably already open. And so go check it out. It's pretty cool. Good question. And one I can answer. Those are always good. All right, anything else? All right. Hey, once again, thank you very much for coming. It's great to have you aboard, and enjoy your stay. Thanks.
A little bit of where I'm at. Right now we are in the hangar bay, which is right below the flight deck. This is basically about the height of maybe a two-story building, between floor and ceiling. And as you can very well see, from starboard right here, and then over to port, you can see we are well underway, on our way to San Diego. We've got some other aircraft in here, of course. I don't know if they're going to actually move them out or not, but that is their decision to make. They're doing what's best for the ship and for everybody on board. And looking over here right now, right there, I caught it just now, that's one of the elevators. One of the elevators is landing, or right, landing. One of the elevators that are coming down to load aircraft or equipment on board. And in this case, they're taking aircraft inside, it looks like. Very far away when they move these aircraft in.
check on him, because he's getting right towards us. I've seen this in the background earlier. I was told this is a Hawkeye. It's called a Hawkeye dual prop plane. I don't know what the dome is on top for. But I don't even know if it's for reconnaissance or targeting. But it's a really unusual looking aircraft.
Thank you.
got karaoke going on right now, as well as an ice cream social. You will not see me singing over here. If I were to go up and start singing, I think security would come in and have me shot. And we're close to the medical bay. They're probably going to help.
These high drag bombs allow the pilot to employ at lower altitude and exit the danger zone without being fragged by their own blast. Piloting Joker 2-1, Lieutenant Commander Benjamin D. Rex Orloff. From over your left shoulder, the F-18, pop attack. Refueling capability is essential for sustained carrier operations. Next, Team Broadsword will display the ability to refuel our aircraft in flight. From Strike Fighter Squadron 137, commanded by Commander Jason Plato Urich, is Lieutenant Commander Jameson Soft Fincher piloting an FA-18E in the tactical tanker configuration, which will provide fuel to an EA-18G Growler from the Gauntlets of Electronic Attack Squadron 136, located in NAS Whidbey Island, Washington. FA-18 Foxtrot, and is the world's premier airborne electronic warfare platform. Ladies and gentlemen, from the left, the wall of water.
Right now to deploy the sensor sonar. The sonar transducer is measure of the vessel. The vessel should meet some of the most advanced manned portable air defense systems. Maneuvering to simulate the delivery of a rescue swimmer into the water.
Machinist mates will actually be coordinating everything from. The bolsa mates will be upstairs. They usually have the Wildcats and the actual brakes upstairs, right, too, right? So they usually tell us we have a communication with one or another one of the seats. Actually, they'll communicate us whenever they want us to engage the Wildcat or they want us to disengage it. When we come here, we'll use our mechanical kind of wrenches to actually engage the Wildcat in order for them to start turning the chain. Racing it up. Sometimes we'll disengage it so that they can lower it down, right? We'll do an evolution that's called a free fall of the chain. Basically what that means is we'll disengage the Wildcat and the chain just goes straight down. That's gravity, pretty much. Gravity takes it, right? That evolution gets done every, I'll say, once every 2 years, and sometimes we do it during insert purposes. For in-service, it's a major inspection evolution that us engineers and the bolsa mates have to go through. And it's actually a pretty cool experience. Some of us, the machine mates, will come around and then we will grease the entire Wildcat, right? We'll just pack it with grease. And once the chain falls, it's every man for themselves. Meaning to say there's gonna be grease flying all over the place. Right? So the first time I ever did it, I was a fireman on board the USS Russell. And you know, I really didn't know much of it, of the evolution. It was my first ever experience. And sure enough, I just caught a load of grease in my face. But it was pretty cool and fun, right? Some of the things that we have here, basically, this is basically just like your car, right? You can think about it as your rotors, and you have your brake pads inside here. When we engage the actual brake, you can see it smoke, right? Especially if it's, we're trying to engage it and trying to stop the chain. There's times where we'll come over here, and if the machinist mate down here is not paying attention, the brake might be engaged, and you'll see the Wildcat and the actual assembly start smoking. All right, it's powered by hydraulics. We have a pump here. It uses 2135, basically the type of oil that we use for hydraulics, and it will also have an emergency brake, which is located on that side. The Bolson mates usually take care of that, right? But if they cannot stop it, then we'll engage our emergency brake. The cool thing about some of the cool features that the anchor witness has too is that if case there is a situation where our emergency brake fails or our power goes out, once power goes out, our emergency brake is actually gonna has a interlock that will actually kick it on, right? So in case, you know, power does go out and we cannot control it, we'll basically still be able to stop it by the power going out, and it's gonna basically engage it itself, okay? The chain is another thing, is divided into shots. Right, once it goes into that red shot, what does that mean, man?
Danger shot, run.
Danger shot, that means run, all right? Because that's basically the last shot of the actual chain. And more than likely, it's gonna go to the ocean, right? We're not gonna try to stop it. We're just gonna run and try to take cover. That's pretty much it for anchor witness. Anybody have questions, comments, or concerns?
Hello.
I'm on what they call the tower now. The basically the island of the ship where everything sticks up on the one side. And here's a look at the flight deck. It's loud because of the helicopter. I learned something really interesting Friday evening when I was over here. Let's take a look at this red spot. Yeah, you see that red spot right there? Where they dropped Osama bin Laden's body after they killed a wacko. So a little bit of interesting information here. I'm gonna see about a bridge tour right now. I don't know if we're gonna do that or not. And they're also going to have a sea power demonstration this afternoon. One thing I forgot to mention, we're not the only ship that's out here in the ocean. We have a fleet around us. I'll see if I can zoom in, but I see at least three other vessels around. There's two of them. And I lost the focus. There's the third one. Thank you.
All right, good afternoon, Tigers and shipmates. Welcome to Carrier Strike Group 1 Sea Power Demo. My name is Lieutenant Ryan Miller, Operations Officer for Destroyer Squadron 1, and I will be your host for this afternoon's main event. For this demonstration, the USS Dewey, USS Sterrett, and USS Lake Champlain will be conducting naval tactical maneuvers, including a gunnery demonstration and full power demonstration.
Kids, so you see how small that flight deck is?
Yeah.
That's why the helicopter has a wheel that comes all the way forward, so it can land on the easier.
All right, one of the first things that you will notice is that all three ships are conducting a coordinated maneuver as they move forward along Carl Vinson's port side. Each ship is maintaining a 500-yard spacing. Each of the ship's COs and bridge teams practice conducting coordinated tactical maneuvers routinely so that they are ready to support our nation's tasking. The most recent evolution that showcased the skill of our naval sailors and those of our partner nations was during the world's largest naval exercise, Rim of the Pacific, more commonly known as RIMPAC. One of the pinnacle achievements during RIMPAC was conducting a photo exercise that required these four ships to be integrated with 34 other ships and 5 submarines from 26 other countries. Each of these ships maintained the same 500-yard spacing forward, behind, and each side of their units for more than 8 hours. This was a true showcase of the training and navigational tactical skills of our ships. The following is a quick history of naval tactics and maneuvering. Over time, naval tactics evolved with the development of naval technology and the evolution of warships. This evolution can best be understood by dividing history as follows. First, galley tactics were naval tactics from the earliest times of the Battle of Lepanto in 1571, which was the last major battle to feature oar-propelled galleys. Next, sailing ship tactics focused on sailing warships, especially from the late 16th century, including the development of the line of battle. During the age of steam, the development of steam ironclad firing explosive shells led to new tactics that were developed for the big gun dreadnought battleships. The mine, torpedo, submarine, and aircraft posed new threats, each of which had to be countered, leading to tactical developments such as anti-submarine warfare and the use of dazzle camouflage. By the end of the steam age, aircraft carriers and submarines had replaced battleships as the principal units of the fleet. However, that did not remove the need for destroyers and cruisers to protect these high-value units when conducting modern warfare. The modern period of naval tactics began with the widespread replacement of naval guns with missiles and long-range combat aircraft after World War II, and is the basis for most of the tactical doctrine used today. As each of these ships come alongside, they will be conducting a demonstration of their main gun and close-in weapon system, commonly known as CWIS. The main gun, more commonly known as the main battery, is a Mark 45 5-inch cannon. The 5-inch 54 caliber Mark 45 lightweight gun is a modern U.S. naval artillery gun consisting of a 127mm Mark 19 gun on a Mark 45 mount. It was originally designed and built by United Defense and is now manufactured by BAE Systems after United Defense was acquired by them. The latest 5-inch 16-inch caliber version consists of a longer barrel Mark 36 gun fitted on the same Mark 45 mount. The gun is designed for use against surface warships, anti-aircraft, and shore bombardment to support amphibious operations. The gun mount features an automatic loader with a capacity of 20 rounds. These can be fired under full automatic control, taking a little over a minute to exhaust those rounds at maximum fire rate. For sustained use, the gun mount would be occupied by a 6-man crew, consisting of gun captain, panel operator, and 4 ammunition loaders. This is all located below deck to keep the gun continuously supplied with ammunition. A close-in weapon system, or CWIS, is a point defense weapon system for detecting and destroying short-range incoming missiles, enemy aircraft, aircraft and surface vessels which have penetrated the outer defenses of a strike group, typically mounted shipboard in naval capacity. Nearly all classes of larger modern warships are equipped with some kind of SeaWiz device. There are two types of SeaWiz systems. A gun-based SeaWiz usually consists of a combination of radars, computers, and multiple barrel rotary rapid-fire cannons placed on a rotating gun mount. Missile systems use infrared or semi-active radar terminal guidance to hit their threat. In some cases, this technology was converted to support protecting bases that are in a higher threat environment. In this case, the SeaWiz will also function the same and protect the base from shell and rocket fire. Currently on the Carl Vinson's port beam, we have the USS Sterrett, which is the fourth ship of the U.S. Navy to be named after Andrew Sterrett, a U.S. naval officer who fought in the Quasi War and the Barbary Wars. The contract to build the USS Sterrett was awarded to Bath Ironworks Corporation in Bath, Maine on 13 September 2002. On 17 November 2005, her keel was laid down and she was christened on 19 May 2007. The ship's sponsor was Michelle Sterrett Burnson, a familial descendant of Andrew Sterrett, who himself had no children. She is commanded by Commander Claudine Calori, a native of Colorado. Sterrett's motto is Forever Dauntless. Her commissioning took place in Andrew Sterrett's birthplace of Baltimore, Maryland on 9 August 2008. USS Sterrett's most recent deployment was February to May of this year with the WASP Expeditionary Strike Group. This deployment included a visit to Guam, Hong Kong, the Philippine Sea, the Sea of Japan, and also the South China Sea. The Sterrett is an Arleigh Burke-class destroyer. She displaces 9,200 tons. She has a length of 509 feet. Her beam is 66 feet, which means she is 66 feet wide, and her draft is 31 feet. She is propelled by four General Electric LM2500 gas turbine engines, and she also has two shafts. She can reach speeds of 30 plus knots and is manned by 32 officers and 348 enlisted personnel. Dewey is an Arleigh Burke-class guided missile destroyer, and it's the third Navy ship named after Admiral of the Navy George Dewey, who is the hero of the Battle of Manila Bay during the Spanish-American War. Dewey's motto is Dynamis Ex Cardiis, which is Latin for the will to fight from the heart. It was authorized to be built on 13 September 2002 by Northrop Grumman Ship Systems. The keel was laid down on 4 October 2006 at the company's shipyard in Pascagoula, Mississippi. On 26 January 2008, Dewey was christened in a ceremony in Pascagoula by Deborah Mullen, the wife of Admiral Mike Mullen. Dewey was commissioned in Seal Beach, California on 6 March 2010 as the 55th Arleigh Burke-class destroyer. Dewey is the first ship commissioning for the city of Seal Beach, California, and she is commanded by Louisiana native Commander Paul Lorio. Dewey's most recent deployment was February to April of this year with the WASP Expeditionary Strike Group, where she conducted maritime security operations and theater security cooperation activities. This deployment included a visit to Guam, Sasebo, Japan, the Philippine Sea, and Sea of Japan. After a brief return to home port, she, Sterrett, Lake Champlain, and Carl Vinson then set sail to participate in the world's largest multinational naval exercise, Rim of the Pacific, from June to August of 2018.
Thank you. U.S.S. doing? is the official winner by photo finish is DC Wonder 5 for Dewey. Congratulations to Dewey. Let's give him a round of applause. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our power demo. We hope you enjoyed your time learning a little bit more about our ship or our dealer's view on a daily basis. Enjoy the rest of your tire cruise.
That was the drag race we just had. We lost. Today is Sunday aboard USS Carl Vinson. Not too much is planned for today. There is a resting gear tour later on this afternoon, along with a cigar social, which I'm not going to attend because I don't smoke. And then tonight, for the kids, there's bracelet making and something else. I think it's a spades tournament for the adults. So it's going to be a quiet day today, so it might be a good day just to shoot some video of what to see around here. Change of plans. We're going over to the Fanto for the cigar social now. Okay, we were going to, it was blocked off, but now we're going the right way. Yeah. working on making a paracord bracelet right now. This is as far as I got. This is kind of tougher than I imagined it would be. Okay, I think I have this figured out now. Here's the knot I just made. Going all the way down to this other hook thing. I just have to tighten these up.
Okay.
I think I got it going here. This is what I've got so far.
Yes.
I'm almost done. This is what I got.
Oh, okay.
One side is a lot shorter than the other side, so I messed it up somehow. This will be for me. I'll also make one for my son. Going here the right way. Make a loop.
There is. This next bay over here is going to be
like this right here.
Knocker that goes out that way, and then it's going to be your first.
This other side goes under.
I didn't want to have any together.
Over these two. And through this loop.
When you have a smaller wrist, you can label them.
And then tighten them up.
How do you know how far?
Okay, I got both these done. The black and white one here I messed up on. This one side is all the way at the end. And the blue and white. I actually had to redo that all over again because I had it way too tight, but I got to work on that. So, I'm all done. Tuesday. We are almost back in San Diego. We have one more day to go, so we should be pulling in tomorrow morning. This is late afternoon. I don't even know what time it is, but I know it's in the early evening. So anyway, we're down here. This is the one of the gyms that are on the ship. Got your treadmill, dumbbells, barbells, all that stuff here. Stair machine, everything like that. This also fits into the one of the ship stores. Now we're gonna go near this place here. You see the black area right there? That's the elevator. And there's the opening for it. You will not catch me going over there. You've probably seen a couple of other videos on the internet about it. I do not do elevators because I'm scared to death of them. Okay, I'm gonna show you something that you haven't seen yet. This is where I was sleeping at. This is my cot. They call it the rack. So yeah, this is just a little bed here, and altogether there's three of them in a row, and obviously both sides, so it's a really tight place to sleep at.
Yay!
Hey, today's Wednesday, last day here, and look, we have supposedly land and another ship, which I don't know what it is. Previous volcanic formation, currently known as land. So we have made it back to California.
Thank you. Okay, we're almost pier side right now. I think the only thing left to do after pier side, we just go ahead and gather up all our gear and disembark, and then most likely spend the day and even the evening in San Diego. We were told on a tour of the bridge that the tower crew on the bridge actually goes over to a side room, and that's how they park the ship. But it looks like they are already in that side room. I don't remember exactly where it's at. I think it is right there. So if I'm right, the entire bridge right now is empty, and everybody's over on the starboard bridge, or whatever they call that, just for docking.
I'm gonna sit here till the ship pulls.
told that's a Starbucks right there. Yeah, I can see the logo. And there's all the people waiting to meet us.
That's not yours!
Go down the alley.
Oh, getting ready to disembark right now. Ship is still docking, but I think there's not too much else action except just putting the mooring lines in place. As you can see, yeah, still docking.
Oh, I'm looking for
my. And not to worry, I'm going to censor that kind of language out later on. So anyway, getting ready to disembark. I have to change this battery because I got 36 minutes of battery life left. Okay, that finished up the Tiger Cruise. So now we're back home, obviously. So, altogether, really good, enjoyable week, but it was exhausting. I do have to say that. And I do have some keepsakes here. You may have seen that I was wearing this throughout the cruise. This is the official bag that we had. And we had all kinds of information, information about the Tiger Cruise itself. This came in really useful. The USS Carl Vinson drink container, a drink bottle, and it comes with a little cap in here that you can put juice or whatever, or fruits or whatever in here, and shake it up, you have some kind of a juice. So I drank out of that quite a bit. This is my little name badge that I carried around all the time on a lanyard that does say USS Carl Vinson. I got a couple of pens. I've got one hiding somewhere already. This is a USS Carl Vinson pen. It has has a stylus on it for tablets or whatever. My bracelet that I made, I usually was wearing this, but I need to make sure it's going to stay burnt in place when you burn the ends of it. Looks like it was starting to unravel, so I'm going to fix that. Here's some of the good things I picked up here. USS Carl Vinson Tiger Cruise commemorative coin. That's the coin that we got. And on the back of it, it has the crest for the ship. Obviously, I haven't opened it up yet. But I have opened up this other little doohickey, and I'm going to open it up now to pull this out. This was an official pin for the Tiger Cruise. And it looks so funky. Right here, USS Carl Vinson Tiger Cruise. So all kinds of little goodies we got. So that takes care of Tiger Cruise officially. So, it's been a long video, obviously. I mean, I checked it out, and when I edited this, it's over 2 hours long. So that's the longest video I've ever done. Once I learned how to talk correctly, that is the longest video I've ever done. So, anyway, I am done here. I'm going to put all this stuff away, and I'm going to finish this video up. So now you know what to do. As usual with all my videos, like the video, subscribe to the channel. Hey, you've got comments, questions, anything
put it on the comment section. And do keep it rated E for everyone, because I'd like to have a family, like a family type video thing here. So keep it rated for E for everyone. And until then, I'm going to say 7-3.